Shakespeare. Justices, standing before you today, we will show you that this matter is not ripe enough to be brought to you, to be brought before you today, that there is no inconsistencies to the Constitution where our client's Constitution is concerned, and that this matter, for all intents and purposes, should be remitted back to arbitration as the Court of Court has already ruled. We find that this is a self-created urgency and abuse of court process. Justices, before I proceed on this point, I wish to highlight to the court's attention that although it is not my argument what I'm going to say now, the issue of jurisdiction is not in contention on our part. What we are merely asking is that if at the very least, that the interim interdict be extended until such time that the applicant has exhausted all the internal remedies provided for by the Constitution of our client, which has been also decided by the Court of Court that this matter has to be remitted back to arbitration. Further to this, we say that it would seem that in our view and our client's view, that this is a vexatious litigation. It is a prejudicial exercise in terms of cost. As we have stated in previous submissions, that this federation depends on sponsorship, and this puts a serious end trying to defend this matter against the applicant. It is a strenuous and unnecessary exercise when all mechanisms have been presented to the applicant to exhaust. Now, justices, we understand that it has been given that the applicant, having all rights to resolve this matter by arbitration, as bestowed upon her by Rule 10 of our client's constitution, read together with Section 72 of Promotional Administrative Justice Act. Rule 10 is a mechanism contemplated under an empowering provision, Section 13 of the National Sports and Recreation Act of 1998. For all intents and purposes, which reads, and I'll read it to you, every sports and recreational body will, in accordance with its internal procedures and remedies provided for in its constitution, resolve any disputes arising among its members or with its governing body. The same section provides further that are at the applicant's disposal, my apologies, and it states further on subsection 2 that where a dispute cannot be resolved in terms of subsection 1 above, any member of the sport or recreation body in question who feels aggrieved, or the sport recreation body itself, may submit the dispute to the sports commission. The sports commission must give the decision in relation to any dispute referred to in subsection 1 or 2 above. That best serves the interest of sports and recreation body in question. The sports commission may at any time of its own accord cause the investigation to be undertaken to ascertain any malpractice of any kind, including corruption in the administration, any serious or disruptive divisions between factions, any membership of the sports or recreation body, or the continuation of maintenance of any institutional systems or practices of discrimination based on gender, race, religion, or creed, or violation of the rights and freedoms of individuals or any law, have been made and may ask the minister to approach the President of the Republic to appoint a commission of inquiry referred to in section 84, subsection 2 of the Constitution. Now, this being the remedies that are provided to the applicant, extended also to the empowering provision. Now, find that the applicant, driven by her anxiety, this is a self-created urgency to intervene the proceedings, delay court proceedings, and request a reviewing setting aside of Rule 8. The applicant chose to rather not take the route of internal remedies, but inundate this court with matters that could have easily been resolved through alternative dispute resolution methods provided to her. The court, in mineral sense, the research case, stated that the abuse of process can, as stated, appear in different forms. And the most arguably common type of abuse of process is the use of court rules. For example, to delay the course or deliberately misemploy the claim for urgency. what we see in this case, Justices. We ask that this matter be remitted to arbitration for the following reasons. The arbitration agreement that exists between the parties contained in Rule 10, which reads that any dispute between a person subject to these rules of the SFS shall be determined by way of arbitration under Clause 29 of the Constitution of the South African Sports Confederation and Olympics Committee. Justices, the applicant in this case has failed to show in her previous submissions that her right will solely be vindicated through the court, that by granting or reviewing or setting aside of any provisions or rules contained in the Constitution of the Federation will vindicate her. Therefore, we reiterate that this matter must be remitted back to arbitration. Now, we also see that there is a lack of following due process of the law from the applicant. While we agree that Section 34 gives the applicant the right to seek recourse through the court, but we also have to acknowledge that the same provision that the applicant approaches this court today also gives power to tribunals and forums to apply the law and decide on matters. We also reiterate that Section 34 does not give the right to abuse the court, that judicial review is not there for the taking, as seen on Section 72 of PASHA. Further to this, the applicant has failed to show that no extraordinary circumstances exist that have led her to come before this court and seek this application today. In the event this has fallen, the court held that not all litigants that knock on the court doors will be given an opportunity to argue their cases orally or in writing. The Act is very clear, Justices, that prior to approaching the court, internal remedies have to have been exhausted and complied with. A person can only seek judicial review as a last resort. The arbitration agreement is binding to both parties. Section 3.1 of the Arbitration Act states that of the Arbitration Act provides that unless the agreement otherwise provides, and an arbitration agreement shall not be capable of being terminated except by consent of all parties thereto. There is no such consent that exists, Justices. Justices, we would like to state that also the case that the applicant is stating in Papuli, the Papuli case, where Judge Crohn quoted Telakolia in the Supreme Court, held that private arbitration would, as a starting point, fall within the ambit of the Constitution, of Section 34 of the Constitution. The parties clearly, in this case, agree that this matter is just as applicable to this one that we are seeing today. And also, that by agreeing to arbitration, the parties agree to waive their rights pro tanto. So, before you today, Justices, would also like to state that, at the very least, the applicant could have approached this court to seek further intervention as directed by Section 32 of the National Sports and Recreation. Again, the applicant fails to do this. And the provision further provides that this court may hear the matter, provided that there is consensus between parties, and would like to state that this matter has been brought before this court prematurely. Now, the grounds for judicial review on Rule 8, as the applicants seek as well, we say that if the court finds it susceptible to public review, we submit that the grounds for judicial review have not been met on the following grounds. The decision taken by the Federation, which had the power and authority to make the decision. The applicant is put to prove bias or reasonable suspicion of bias on the part of the respondent, which she has not. The respondent followed all proper procedures as per Rule 10 of the Federation and Clause 29 of SASCOC, which rendered the procedure in light of Rule 8 fair and legal. Chief Justice, if I may, request an additional 2 minutes to sum up. So the decision that was taken by the Federation was taken in good faith, and the applicant was called upon to fairly answer for her actions, which forms part of the nature of justice, a right to be heard. That's all the Federation was asking. She can come in and allow us to hear what she had to say in light of her actions. Now, we find that all the requirements for an interdict, as discussed by the protocol, have not been proven, and states that should all other aspects fail to resolve the matter, it has to be brought before a commission. So what we are saying, as opposed to approaching the courts, she could have, if she feels that her voice will not be heard by the South African Sports Federation for Swimming, she could have gone to the South African Sports Confederation to seek recourse as opposed to directly approaching the courts. So we feel that she did not extend herself to see what other remedies are there for her before approaching the courts, which are clearly there. We are not, the Constitution is there for every member to access. It is not hidden, and hence she's able to dispute Rule 8 and asking it to be reviewed and synthesized because it's there for everyone to adhere to.
Yes, both counsel for the applicant submitted that Ms. Mbodi would be prejudiced if the matter were to be resolved by arbitration. The reason being that the arbitration award would be final and binding, and the constitutional rights of the applicant would not be vindicated within the context of arbitration. Do you perhaps have any authority where constitutional rights have in fact been vindicated in the context of an arbitration award?
I cannot think of anyone at this current moment, but I can put it to this court that the Arbitration Act states that the only issues that cannot be taken to arbitration are issues of matrimonial issues, or I think this is on section 1 of the Arbitration Act, which leads us to believe that every other issue with the application, the applicable law, or the application of the law by an arbitrator or presiding officer that has been appointed may be addressed. Also, arbitration awards are capable of